As we worship together here at the New Life Evangelistic Center, you're going to have an opportunity to be a part of a miracle, to understand what it means to be reconciled to God. That opportunity exists for each of us as we continue to search God's Word. In this case, take a look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5.
Whether it's a heat crisis, severe cold spell, or a person without a home, New Life Evangelistic Center is engaged with the hurting in mid-America. Around the clock, staff labor to help those in hopeless situations. In order to be able to reach out in this way, the NLEC staff find singing, praying, and worshiping God together to be essential in their labor of love. We invite you now to join Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of the New Life Evangelistic Center as they worship God together with the fatherless, widowed, and homeless. Let the same Holy Spirit who strengthens them daily minister to you as you join them in renewing your commitment to serve our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in reaching out to the world around us.
The theme of the New Life Evangelistic Center is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. If anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. That's been our theme all these years. What does it mean? It means that we can be reconciled to God. I'm going to ask Pastor Ray Redlick to come and share with you from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 to 21, and understand what it means to be reconciled to God. And as he shares, my prayer is that this miracle of reconciliation will take place in your life. Pastor Ray.
2 Corinthians 5, we're going to read verses 14 through 21. For the love of God, the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Very important passage. And I think that this passage really summarizes the Christian life in many ways. And it brings forth that very important concept of being reconciled. What does it mean to be reconciled? Well, we're going to look at that as we go through the message here, but I want us to see the full scope of being reconciled to God, the broad implications of what's involved. And so therefore, the points of my message are, number one, our need. Two, what God has done. Three, being personally reconciled. Four, how we should live. And five, the ministry of reconciliation. So we're going to go through those 5 points. First, our need. In other words, our condition without Christ. To put it very simply, without Jesus Christ, you and I are enemies of God. I might say, enemies? Well, I've never been God's enemy. I rather like God. I think he's pretty cool, and I consider myself to be God's friend. Well, we can be God's friend, and I hope that we all are or will become God's friends, but that's not our natural condition. Our natural condition is to be an enemy of God. because of our own sin and selfishness. You see, God is God, and when we try to make ourselves God, when we try to play God in one way or another, we become His enemy, and that's basically what sin is. Sin is putting self first, making self God. And that means that we become enemies of God. And that's why we need to be reconciled to God. Because we're enemies. What does the word reconcile mean? Well, according to Verlander and Brown, it means the restoration of the original understanding between people after hostility or displeasure. Let me say that again. The restoration of the original understanding between people after hostility or displeasure. So it's a word talking about relationships. Reconciliation deals with relationships. There was a relationship that was broken, and now it becomes fixed. That's, put it very simply, what reconciliation is. And we hear about it in terms of people, individuals, husbands and wives, parents and children. We hear about it in even sometimes in terms of nations, countries that become reconciled. But usually it's in terms of people. And of course, the greatest reconciliation of all is when we become reconciled to God. And that becomes then the foundation of all other forms of reconciliation. If we're going to be really reconciled with one another, we have to be reconciled with God. And to be restored to a right relationship. We were enemies, but we become His friends, His children. Now, of course, that implies that there was a prior condition before that that was destroyed, that was lost. And that's true. When God first made Adam and Eve, they were right. They were in a right relationship with God. But when they sinned, when they disobeyed God, they made themselves gods in their own thinking, and they fell from God's favor, from His grace, and they needed to be reconciled. Never since then, every human being needs to be reconciled with God, because we're all sinners, with the exception of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the only one without sin. So we all need to be reconciled to God. And it's a serious thing to be an enemy of God. Think about it. There's only one God, only one creator of all the universe. And if we fall out of favor with Him, we're in bad shape. We're all going to die someday. And if we die separated from God, we're going to be separated from Him for all eternity in hell. Sin is a terrible thing. But you know, God doesn't want us to be lost in sin. God does want us to be saved. And that's why He's given us the good news. And we're going to look secondly now at what God has done. We've seen about our need, how we're lost, we're enemies of God, but now we can be reconciled to God. God wants us to be reconciled. That's what we're going to look at now, what God has done. Notice in the verse, one of the verses that we read, verse 18, it says, "Now all things are of God." And that really puts everything right at the center. God is at the center. The whole plan of reconciliation, the whole plan of salvation has God at the center. All things are of God. And you know, if you're going to come to the truth in your life, if you're going to get your life on the right footing and everything, you got to start by putting God at the center. And that's a big part of our problem, that we have ourselves at the center, and so everything then is off center. Everything is twisted. Everything is distorted because we put self at center. But it says, now all things are of God. It originates with Him. Well, praise God that that's good for us, because we couldn't do it ourselves. We are helpless. Now, we're not only, because of sin, we're not only sinful, we're not only hopeless, but we're also helpless. We cannot save ourselves. So if it weren't for the fact that all things are of God, we'd be in bad shape. But praise God, all things are of God. All the whole plan of salvation is of God. He took the initiative. And I'd like to look once again at these verses, 18 and 19. Just read these together here today. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Praise God, that's so awesome. God was in Christ. The Father was there in the Son. It was the Son of God, Jesus, that came to save us. We see a picture of the Trinity here. God the Father was there present in Christ to reconcile the world to himself. And so we see the work of God, the love of God, as it says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." God was in Christ. And another important verse is verse 21. And I want to take just a few moments to look at this verse, because it says so much. "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Now I realize this verse can be a little puzzling, because there's a lot of he's and hims in here, and you have to know who's the he and who's the him. When it says he made him, that means God the Father made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we, that's us sinners, might become the righteousness of God in him, in Jesus Christ. And as I said, that this verse says a lot. We have to first of all understand that Jesus was sinless. He who knew no sin, that's Jesus Christ. He who knew no sin, Jesus, the man, the God-man, he knew no sin. He was without sin. He was guiltless. It's not only that he never did anything bad, but he was pure. Everything he did was from a pure motive, not tainted by selfishness whatsoever. Now, you can't say that about us, can you? Now, the greatest, the most loving people on this earth, even a lot of the good things we do, are tainted by wrong motives. With Jesus, it never was. He never sinned at all. He is perfectly righteous. As it says in Hebrews 7:26, it describes Jesus. It says, "Who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens." That's a description of Jesus in Hebrews. And also in Hebrews 4:15, it says that he was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. So Jesus was tested and found perfect, pure. He was tempted, but he never sinned. Praise God. And therefore, he qualifies to be our Savior. He who knew no sin. But then it goes on to say he was made sin for us. That's the awesome part of it. Jesus took our sins upon him. You could say that our sins were charged to his account. It's not that he ever participated in sin. He never was a sinner. But he took the punishment of our sins. Our sins were laid on his account, and he suffered the wrath of God because of our sin. Jesus, who had never done anything wrong at all. Now, you and I, if we get punished, if we get blamed in the slightest way for something that we're not responsible for, or we feel that we're not responsible for, now you and I, we get upset, don't we? If somebody stole something and we didn't do it, we never thought about doing it, and then we get blamed for it, well, we become indignant. But just think of Jesus. All of the things that you and I have done wrong were laid upon him. He who knew no sin. All he had done was he had lived a selfless life for 33 years, suffering all the abuse of this earth here for 33 years, and never sinned, did everything for all the other people. And he gets put on a cross. Not only all the physical suffering, but then he suffered for our sins too on top of that. Even God the Father put his anger upon Jesus because of our sins. It's unthinkable. But that's love. That's the love of God for you and me. He felt the wrath of God. That's why he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, Jesus never stopped being God himself. He was always divine. He never changed his nature. But what happened was he felt the wrath of God at that time. For the first time in his life, he felt God's anger. Because at that moment, the sins of the world were upon him. The Lord, as it says in Isaiah 53, I want to read this here because it's such an awesome passage. In Isaiah 53, verses 5 and 6, it goes right along with this passage that we have been reading in 2 Corinthians. It says, but he, Jesus, was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. That's almost the exact same statement as we read, where it says, he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. Here it says, the Lord, God the Father, has laid on him, the Savior, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. God put our sins upon his Son, Jesus. Why? It's the only way we could be saved. So that now, when we believe on Jesus, what does it say in verse 21? That we might become the righteousness of God in him. So we receive his righteousness. I like to call it the great exchange. The great exchange. We exchange our sins for Christ's righteousness. That's amazing. Now, it's not a very fair exchange from the Lord's point of view. He's getting the bad end of the deal. He took our punishment on the cross. We're getting the totally good end of the deal when we receive Jesus. We receive his righteousness, salvation, eternal life. It's a gift. It's grace. That's what the word grace means. It's a free gift from God. The great exchange. And God, this is what God has done for us. It's already been done. Jesus said, it is finished. It's already been accomplished, what God has done. But you know, that doesn't mean that all people are automatically saved. We must each believe on Jesus. We must each, by faith, receive him as our Savior and Lord. Salvation is not an automatic thing that just is imparted to all people. Jesus died for all people. I believe that. But it's only when we receive him by faith that we receive the benefits then of that salvation. That's what our passage here is talking about in being reconciled to God. See, the reconciliation is not complete until we accept it. He's done everything to reconcile us. You could say he has redeemed us at Calvary, Jesus has. But we only receive that reconciliation then when we believe on Jesus. That's why the Apostle Paul says, be reconciled to God. That's an individual thing. We must each be reconciled to God. Jesus has paid the price for our salvation. God is willing to save us. In fact, he sends out people to bring the word of God to us. But we must receive that gift through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. And that's why I, along with the Apostle Paul here, who wrote this passage in 2 Corinthians, I say to you today, as though God were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Everybody under the sound of my voice, I implore you today, be reconciled to God. Amen. I can't do any more than that. The Holy Spirit is dealing with you. Now, you be reconciled to God. You can't save yourself. I'm not trying to imply that in any way. But yet, God tells us here, be reconciled to God. Receive him now. Receive Jesus Christ as Lord of your life. Be reconciled to God. I'd like to just take a moment in the service right now and give you an opportunity to make sure to settle this issue in your own life. I invite you to pray with me, wherever you may be, and call upon Jesus Christ today. Be reconciled to God. I invite you to pray this prayer with me and really mean it from your heart. Lord Jesus, I come to you. Thank you, Lord, for this awesome gift of salvation. Thank you for paying the price for my sins, for enduring the suffering that I deserved. I turn from my sins and I accept you, Lord Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. Wash away my sins, fill me with your Spirit, and help me to live for you. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Jesus said, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. When we come to Jesus sincerely, he will not turn us away. He's more than willing to receive us, to save us, and to change our lives. And that brings us then to the next point, my fourth point, how we should live. How we should live. I want to look again at verse 15 of our passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I'm going to read it again. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. That's a verse that's worth memorizing. That those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. It's for Jesus. So Jesus then becomes the center of our affections. We live now for him. That's a very radical concept. And it goes against everything that we've learned, everything we've done in our past. We've basically lived for ourselves. But when we come to Jesus, we have a calling now to live for him. And that's why the Apostle Paul says in the previous verse, in verse 14, it says that if one died for all, then all died. Well, When we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we die to self. We die to the old life. And through baptism, this is presented. If you haven't been baptized, you should be baptized in water. Because in baptism, then we bury the old life, the old self. We rise again to newness of life with Christ. It's all with or in Jesus Christ. So this is all part of the biblical understanding of the Christian life. And of course, I realize that there's a lot of different aberrations, or people will go one this way or that way with the Christian life. Some will try to promote the material prosperity, and that becomes the focus then. Or some will get into legalism, where they say the Christian life is a list of rules, do's and don'ts, and it gets off center. Let's keep Jesus Christ at the center. He's the Redeemer, he's the Savior, and he's our Lord. Let's keep Jesus at the center. Because through Jesus, then, once we have been reconciled to God, we receive a new perspective on Jesus Christ, on other people, on ourselves, and on life itself, a new perspective. And there's a real change that takes place. And that's what verse 17 brings out. It's probably the best known verse in our passage that we read. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Praise God. That's a breath of fresh air for us. Jesus makes all things new when we are in Christ. Of course, that phrase in Christ is so crucial. It's what I've been talking about, making sure that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That phrase in Christ is used over and over, especially in the writings of the Apostle Paul. I encourage you to just to meditate what it means to be in Christ. This picture that's presented here in verse 17 is often illustrated with the idea of a butterfly. Now, the caterpillar goes through a metamorphosis in which it kind of hibernates for a while, and it comes out of the cocoon or the chrysalis as a new creature, it seems to be. A new creature. It has wings now. It's totally different from the previous one. Well, I think that God has given us such things in nature like that to help us to better appreciate the change that takes place through God's power. And it is through God's power. It's not through the willpower of that little caterpillar that it has changed. The caterpillar doesn't even know what's going on. But God does the work. God does the changing in our lives. It illustrates the tremendous power of God in changing our lives. We sometimes use the term sanctification. It refers to what God does in our lives as believers. The justification is what God has done for us. Sanctification is what God does in us. Praise God. And that brings me then finally to the fifth point, the ministry of reconciliation. And it wouldn't be complete if I left out this other point, because it comes out loud and clear in what Paul has written here. God has given the ministry of reconciliation to his people. Paul, as an apostle, had that ministry. He was very conscious of it. It was the ever-present motivation, the purpose of his life, to reconcile people to God, or to bring the word of reconciliation, I should say. We call it the ministry of reconciliation. Now, God has done the reconciling through Jesus Christ, but he has imparted to us the ministry of reconciliation to his people, that we can reach out to others. And I think it's so beautiful that God has done it this way. God uses the reconciled to bring the message of reconciliation to others. That's just the way God has chosen to do it, and I think it's wonderful. You know, he could have chosen angels to be the ones that bring the gospel. He could have said, okay, you're saved, stay over here. I'm going to send forth my angels to bring in more people. He didn't do it that way. He said, you're saved. Now I'm sending you out to bring in more people. I'm sending you out to those who haven't yet received that message of reconciliation. I'm giving you the word of reconciliation to bring to them. God uses us. In fact, the Apostle Paul uses the term ambassadors for Christ. An ambassador, in the ancient times as well as today, represented the head of state, the king or the leader of the country. And what the ambassador said was not his own feelings. And even today, the ambassador doesn't express his opinions. He expresses the opinions of the president or of his head of state. And so today we, as ambassadors for Christ, aren't just representing ourselves, we're representing Jesus. And that is a tremendous responsibility. And if you have received Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want you to start thinking about that, that God has called you, not just you alone, but all of us as his children, to be ambassadors for Christ, to bring the message of reconciliation to others. Somebody brought it to you, and now God is giving you the chance to bring it to others. Be faithful at that. Let God use your life. Amen.
Thank you, Ray, for sharing that with us. Yes, as the scripture says, anyone, 2 Corinthians 5:17, the theme of the work of New Life Evangelistic Center, be in Christ. They're a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. I thank God for that newness and the opportunity he gives us. And now as a new creation in Christ, we're going to want to be that light and salt that God is calling us to be at this time. We give you those opportunities here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. Go to newlifeevangelisticcenter.org and look at all the opportunities awaiting you there. It's the theme of the work of the New Life Evangelistic Center from 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. Father God, I come with my brothers and my sisters, and I ask, Lord, that this newness might flow through us this week. We may be instruments of healing and hope, reaching out to those that are in need, the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, the homeless, the lonely. Let your light and love flow through us. Thank you, Almighty God, for providing that reconciliation through Christ Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC, along with the fatherless, widowed, and homeless in their midst, ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior. You can receive an audio version of this message by sending a gift of $3 or more to NLEC, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. And please specify the program number and title of this message.